Hey everyone, Dave here with a quick word of warning about this week's episode. Unfortunately, Zoom decided to get a bit finicky with us, so you're going to see some audio-video sync issues, hear a couple audio kind of glitches, but pretty much everything we wanted to say is in there, and we had a great time talking about this movie. We're talking about a 50s rock and roll fairy tale, except that it's viewed through the lens of sweat-soaked neon haze. That's right, folks, we're talking Streets of Fire this week on Screen Geeks. Hey everyone, welcome to Screen Geeks. This is Dave.
This is Tom Cody.
Wow, all right. You're going to do this for every movie now, aren't you?
Oh, come on. I had my glasses on earlier. I could be Billy Fish, but I'm feeling Tom Cody right now. So,
fair enough. And joining us for a very special occasion, this is kind of us paying tribute and homage to one of the legends of the Denver film scene who's brought a lot of love for a lot of film to a lot of folks, including us. Mr. Keith Garcia from Denver Film is joining us again. Thanks for coming back, sir, and belated happy birthday.
Thank you so much, and it's glad to be back.
Yes, we're excited. Because last time you were on, I was like, hey, we'd love to have you back. What do you want to do? You know, is there a movie that you love? In the past, it's been Houseu or who knows what. And you were like, look, every year I screen the same movie and I had not seen it. So I watched it and I was like, yes, we need to have you back. And belated happy birthday again, just a couple days ago. So we're going to put this up tomorrow. Like, I'll be encoding it tonight and uploading it tomorrow so everyone can see it within time. But what movie are we watching tonight or talking about tonight, sir?
Well, we are going to watch Streets of Fire, the amazing Walter Hill vehicle from 1984. Like an introduction,
if you want, I want to let you. So when I posted on Facebook that we're doing this episode on my personal, I was shocked by the number of people who were like, "I love this movie," and I'm like, "How have I not seen this movie in my life? How has it not been in my life before this?"
Yeah.
So yes, for those who may not know, this is kind of an opportunity to continue the yearly tradition of introducing the film.
Well, thank you. Well, to get an introduction underway with this film, I'll just say welcome to another time, another place. You're about to watch a film that shouldn't exist for many reasons. Number one, it's a film that mashes so many genres, places, times, aspects, everything together, and it should just topple over on its heavy style and what it's trying to achieve with all of these aspects. But a film that defies those odds by being so like well-written and tight, like there is not an ounce of fat in this movie. It is a pure from beginning to end, with an amazing soundtrack that drives it, with fantastic performances all around of it, including some very early work from people that we now really count on to be like quality actors. It's kind of a, if you've ever loved genre films, like the very notion of genre, Streets of Fire is for you. Like it is a love letter to all of that, to cinema and genre and just everything. It's got everything you want. There literally is nothing in this film that you'll be wanting afterwards. Wait, did I say that right? You'll be want for nothing afterwards because this will fill you up with everything that you want in a movie and more. So there you go.
All right, let's roll the trailer and then we'll part of the trailer so we don't get copyright strikes or anything. But we'll be back to talk Streets of Fire and the glorious insanity that is ahead of us.
You are about to enter a world unlike any you've ever seen before, where rock and roll is king. The only law is a loaded gun. Where the beautiful
stay and see the show, it's really good.
The brutal,
I want Tom Cody,
and the brave all meet.
From now on, it's for real.
In Streets of Fire.
So
That was the trailer for Streets of Fire. This film was very much overlooked when it came out in the summer of 1984. This is one of these situations, and I'm really excited to dig into it with you and Keith, and to get a sense of what it was like for you when you first discovered this movie. I'll say very quickly that this was a film that I discovered on HBO, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later. On the one hand, I want to set the table and say that, you know, it came out, this is Walter Hill post 48 Hours, coming off the, you know, the high of that movie, one of the top grossing films of the year. So Universal Studios, as Keith indicated, gave him the insane reach to make this film the way he wanted. It is an uncompromised film. It is very much the work of a director who has a passion for a very tangible world. I am such a fan of any movie that thrusts us into this world and does not explain itself at all. I love these kinds of movies because most films, you know, they like, you were in this world, this is the setting, these are the rules. This movie just takes off. It explodes out of the starting gate. And we're in this world that's a blend of the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and take it or leave it, folks. It's like a version of the past, the way we remember it, or the way it sounds in a song, as opposed to anything resembling reality. But it's also a film that feels real somehow, real and surreal. But I digress. It opened up the same summer as The Karate Kid, The Terminator, Ghostbusters, Star Trek III. I think maybe the fact that Michael Pear, forgive me if it's Pear, I think it's Michael Pear. Michael Pear and Diane Lane were really not, you know, strong enough, obviously, to open the film on their own. And perhaps Walter Hill's name wasn't strong enough to open the film. But it's one of these movies where the soundtrack tends to be what gets the people into the movie. They know the soundtrack, and it kind of like, that's where that alignment happens. And for me, it was discovering this movie on HBO. Before we get into it, let me just go ahead and admit this very embarrassing fact about this movie. I was hesitant to admit it, but I'm going to admit it because hopefully this will be amusing, or this could just be dead air for 2 minutes. So I saw this film as a child on HBO, and I saw it once from beginning to end on HBO. It struck me as a very grown-up movie at the time, but I really dug it, especially the musical numbers. For years, I kind of remember this movie as being a musical because of how good the musical numbers are, and I think they're wonderful. But so at the end of the film, the film group, the Sorrells sing I Could Dream About You, for years, I believed that they were the ones who sang the song. In fact, I misremembered this movie for most of my adult life. I misremembered thinking that Robert Townsend sung this song. So for most, and I'm 43, most of my adult life, whenever I'd hear that song on the radio, I'm like, oh, it's Robert Townsend, it's the Meteor Man. I actually remember going to a movie and seeing a trailer for The Five Heartbeats, and I'm like, well, of course, he's a musical guy. I mean, like, you know, I'm so glad he's getting back into singing. So for like years and years and years, for whatever reason, the connection did not happen. And then like a couple of years ago, again, just a few years ago, I'm watching VH1. They've got like one of their retro videos, and it's like Dan Hartman, I Can Dream About You. I'm like, oh, maybe it's a cover song. And I'm watching the video. I'm like, no, who's the white guy with the poofy hair? This is a song by a bunch of African Americans. Anyway, for most of my life, I was not acknowledging the work of Dan Hartman, and I want to come clean about that tonight.
I'm proud of you, sir.
Apologizing for discounting the magic of cinema to completely make you think something totally different. Like, Diane Lane didn't sing her songs either.
That's right. That's right.
I'll be honest. I thought at first, I didn't catch that it was a lip sync at first. I'm like, wow, she's really not. Wait a minute.
I mean, that's a testament to, I mean, every actor in this movie is like, there's just such an energy, and there's so many things from fight scenes to lip syncing to all that stuff that could have destroyed this movie. Like, done incorrectly, done half-assed, like any of that stuff. But everything, you know, and as a testament to Walter Hill, and just, you know, not just 48 Hours, but The Warriors before that, and anything else he worked on, you know, just brought it all in together, and yeah, but yeah, Dan Hartman, always remember that. If you're looking up for the song in karaoke, which I've done before, it's Dan Hartman.
Well, since I'm new to this, I only saw it a month ago. Where? Oh, go ahead.
Yeah. Yeah, no. I was just going to ask you, Dave. Like, so you just saw this film for the first time. What was that experience like for you?
I watched the trailer and I'm like, oh my goodness, I need this movie in my life now, because it's Nowhere Fast is over the trailer on the Shout Factory trailer, and I was just like, I'm in. Where can I get it? Oh look, Vudu has it for $7 in HD. Bought. I'm watching it tonight, and this movie is not, like you said, Keith, this movie has zero wasted time. Like, there is no setup. Mm-hmm. Like, after the song starts, Willem Dafoe shows up and the movie's going. And I was just completely floored by that opening number. Like, Steph came in. I was like, wait, honey, wait. You need to watch the beginning of this movie. And she didn't stick around for it. I will get her to watch it at some point. But I was just like, that's how impactful that opening number was. It's just so well done. And it's just all on there. Like, it'd be easy to phone in a lip sync, but Diane Lane is throwing her entire soul into that performance, which was what made me think that it was really happening. Mm-hmm. I had no idea what to expect. And so I'm like, rock and roll fairy tale. Is this a musical? And it's not, but the music in it is so good. However, I was worried. I'm like, there's nothing going to like live up to Nowhere Fast. Like, it's such a good song. I don't know. You know, the rest of this music is really good. It's just not going to make it. And then we get Tonight Is Only for Love or whatever. And I'm like, okay, I waffle between which song I like better, but the performances were just so stinking good. Except, you know, I mean, Tom Cody, God bless him. I'm sure this is supposed to be a star maker movie, but I'm scared to look at his IMDb.
I mean, Michael Paredes had made his way through a few things. He definitely had a career, and it was mostly in the 80s. I mean, he's still a very handsome man right now. But I'm just looking him up really fast because there was a few credits around this time. That
he's got a lot of credits. Holy
cow. So, well, before Streets of Fire... he was in Eddie and the Cruisers.
Yes.
That was the movie that really made him who he was, and probably got him noticed for this. And I would actually say, whether or not it's his acting, he is supposed to be the muscle, the lunkhead, the I only have a couple of things I care about and very few words to say guy. And for that, it's perfect.
he feels like...
I'm going to
wear
my high-waisted pants and suspenders.
Totally. Well, it feels a lot like it's kind of like trying to do the James Dean version of John Wayne. I think that's exactly. Kind of a fair way to put it.
And yeah, for sure. And that just is like, you know, going back to the screenplay by Larry Gross and Walter Hill, you know, this is obviously like a Western funneled through... For sure. Through neon and through the 50s Americana and pop music at the time. I mean, 84, we were just a little bit into MTV and stuff like that. Even though none, aside from I Can Dream About You, none of those songs I feel were kind of made for MTV. Like, there weren't any exact pop hits out of that. Like, I think I Can Dream About You was the only song they tried to get on the radio. Nowhere Fast and Tonight Is What It Means to Be Young are, though, by Jim Steinman, who by then had done Bonnie Tyler's like Total Eclipse of the Heart and Hero and a whole bunch of other stuff. Meatloaf's entire early career was Jim Steinman. That was not the MTV set. Ry Cooder is also not the MTV audience. So, but you could just tell that that's, you know, these were the elements being played with. What if a Western existed in an MTV era? How do we get those people, that audience? But without overthrowing it, that's the real magic that Streets of Fire does, is it doesn't shoot so far out of its league that it completely misses its audience altogether. It just, I think, because that summer was jam-packed. I mean, you had what will essentially be like 10 iconic films come out that summer and even later in the year. And I know it was a summer release. I remember, I didn't see it myself until HBO. I'm like you, Barry, watched it a million times that way. But I remember going to the movies and seeing a variety of, like, they, you know, when was a Blockbuster, yeah. And they do like 5 posters for the movie. I remember distinctly 5 different neon color posters for Streets of Fire, like on a wall. And so Universal had big intentions with this movie. They thought it was going to be a big hit. Oops. But I think that's just because, how do you describe it? That's the other part. It's like, I don't know. I want to go see Ghostbusters. So.
It's a heck of, I mean, it's not really a hard sell, because once you get the point across, it's, I don't know anyone who wouldn't be in for it. But yeah, it is, it's yeah. kind of hard to give a quote unquote elevator pitch on this movie.
And that's kind of all the more reason why it's been my a personal goal to get as many people as possible into a movie theater to watch it, and around another way where it's like, come watch this movie that I'm really excited about. And if people follow me, listen to anything that I do, or have trusted me in other programming, they tend to be like, oh, okay. Well, if you really like this movie, it'll probably be okay. And then that's my hope, is that then they're like, cool, that was really great, thank you. But yeah.
Yeah, there have been times, like I've been to things that you've programmed that maybe haven't connected with me. I think the primary example was the ABCs of Death. I think I actually walked out of the theater, walked up to you and said, Keith, what the actual F did I just watch? And you just kind of went, you watched a movie, buddy. But your passion has always
been... You watched 26 short films.
Yes, I did. And whew, those were some movies for sure. But like your passion, and you've steered me right so many times. It's like, I'm never going to like say, no, I'm not doing anything Keith says again. It's... You know, my horizons might be stretched, and more often than not, it's definitely rewarded. So it's like, I can totally see people being like, well, Keith likes it, so of course I'm going to come see it.
Well, I appreciate that trust being thrown. That's what I count on. I count on that trust, meaning making up for something. I will say something you mentioned earlier, too, about another reason why this film's great is... I truly feel this movie is bookended so perfectly by those two songs. Like if you took away those songs as the entrance and exit of the film, it would be a completely different experience and probably not work as well. But you need both the, like, I mean, I call Jim Steinman's music motorcycle music, because generally he does have a literal motorcycle recording of a motorcycle like kickstarting, like, is part of the music, and that's what both Nowhere Fast and Tonight Is What It Means to Be Young is it's just it revs it up and gets it going. And that's the thing too, there's barely any words said. There's little side dialogue in the first 5-6 minutes of that film while the song's going on. You have Rick Moranis, which, credit to Rick Moranis in his first, like, butch asshole role as well. Like, it's like he did that once and then never again. But that's fine. We have it on film that he did it, and he did it well. But he says a few words about, you know, stupid, never going to make any money managing these bands, etc. And then you go into this performance with Ellen Aim and the Attackers, and then, yeah, there's no need for any other side dialogue. It's, you're going to watch this performance. Hey, there's this group of ominous men coming into this theater. What's going on? Oh, this guy looks really creepy. The song ends. We're all into it. And then she's kidnapped. And then the whole, everything goes to hell. And it wafts into this nice, like, there's still no dialogue, like real conversation dialogue, as Tom Cody's sister goes and writes a telegram sending for Tom Cody. And then he makes his way on a subway over to the city, and then it just really isn't until he's sitting at the diner saying hello, and then this other punk gang comes in and he shows who he is as a defender and a tough guy, that we're actually getting dialogue. And it's like, but that's perfect. That's what Tarantino ruined, a lot of things, and thankfully this is pre-Tarantino, but Tarantino created this notion since Pulp Fiction, since Reservoir Dogs even, I think, that kind of ruined cinema. And it's that any aspiring screenwriter, filmmaker needs to write 40 pages of dialogue for every character before you even get into the action of the movie. And it's a problem because Tarantino can do it. Very few other people can. And so looking back at something like Streets of Fire, Larry Gross, who also wrote 48 Hours, I think really had just a great idea of cinema and how you're supposed to, it's a golden rule of cinema. And pardon me if I keep digressing a little bit. to me, it's a golden
rule of cinema. It's part and parcel for us, man. Ago. Don't worry about it.
Any movie, there you go. Any movie that's worth its salt, you should be able to watch with the sound off. And I think that Streets of Fire is definitely like that. Now, it's a pity if you're watching it with the sound off because of the music and a lot of the sound design of the entire movie. But in cinematic cues, in what's going on, you're getting the story. If you were just watching that, you'd get the, you'd figure out what was going on without having to get the dialogue. And when you get to the dialogue, it's great. Some of my favorite conversations in that movie are between Tom Cody and McCoy, who also, at a young age, you know, watching that on, that was 84 when it came out in theaters. I'm sure it hit HBO in 85. There was, it always, you know, it did that VHS route for a few months before the, anything hit cable. I was probably like 8 years old. And there was just something about watching Streets of Fire and my like gay IQ picked up on McCoy very much so. and it's funny, you know, registering her as a lesbian character, which it's never said, though it's implied. And the very first thing when they, when she meets Tom Cody, she even tells him, "You're not my type." Like, that's just a bold, "You're not my type." And he's just like, "Well, maybe later." And she's just like, "Probably not." Like, it's, she's literally telling him.
You missed the underline along with the bold.
Not going to happen. Exactly. And speaking of, you know, I told you earlier that I rewatch it every time that I've done it. And I watched it this afternoon before this podcast. And something I noticed, which I hadn't before, is that there's the... the very, I call her kind of a butch go-go dancer in Porchies. Gets very like sexy and naked, but at the same time, I kind of always kind of equated her a little bit too as being like a butch lesbian because she's not taking any shit from these men. Like, because I think she just doesn't have to. She's just like, "I'm here making a buck. I'm going to dance sexy because I like doing that. And I'm going to do this." But when McCoy goes into Torchies, when they're trying to rescue Ellen, it's McCoy walking in and she turns her head and the next cut is to the butch dancer on the bar. And I was like, I think that was the editor and Walter Hill being like, "Let's give some cues to the world that we're dealing, we have a gay character in this film. We maybe can't, or the studio is not going to like it if we just call it out." But at the same time, they didn't need to. There wasn't anything more than just the basic understandings for everyone and every character in that movie to know just a little bit to get so much enjoyment out of them and to have them be totally different people than what's normally written for a standard character like that. The hero character, the... damsel in distress, the villain, the sidekick, all those are given such an extra little oomph in this movie. And just more about why I love it.
You, that dancer is really striking because...
And you guys should talk.
No, it's okay. No, it's okay. It's okay. It's like I said, happy birthday. No, but what really struck me about this film in general is the amount of restraint that it still has. Because it'd be very easy for that scene with the dancer. It is very sexy. She's definitely, she's giving, you know, she's dancing to the music. The music, she's flowing with the music. Mm-hmm. But it would be so easy for there to just be gratuitous nudity in there. And it doesn't exist. I was waiting for it to happen. Not like with bated breath or anything. But I'm like, this is about the time where it would happen. And it never does. And I really admire the choices that they made like that. Because it let the scene breathe without degrading it, I guess.
Mm-hmm. And then you have, you know, she's in a thong, which yes. I feel is one of the first like thongs I saw in a movie at the time. And she's even in like the crop top, and there is a little like nip slip and whatever. But what you're also seeing is like these men are like, it's they're being in, they're enjoying at the same time that they're not. There's no worry about her. Like that's a scene that normally in another movie from 1984. I would have been like, I'm worried about the woman in this situation. And this one, I was like, she's just getting, this woman is living her best life.
She is in control through that entire scene. There's no doubt about it.
She is in control. You got this. You got this. Don't worry about it.
So. Were you going to say something, Barry?
Oh, I'm more than happy to talk about the Marine Jahan dance scene from Streets of Fire. Oh yeah, man. You know, for anybody who doesn't, anyone who's not a child of the 80s, this is the woman who was famous because she did all of Jennifer Beals' dancing in Flashdance. She is, you know, it's one of those things where she's obviously one of the sexiest women on the planet, and they just had no idea what kind of movie career to give her. It happened to Cynthia Rhodes that same decade. Let's talk about Amy Madigan for a second. This is somebody who, like, I love the way she's used in this movie. She's great. She's great in everything, but most movies, I mean, I'm sorry, Uncle Buck, like there's most movies, they didn't know what to do with her.
Yeah.
I love her in this movie. And obviously I think she won the Oscar for Pollock. She's amazing. And most movies like just never utilize the fact that she didn't look like every other movie star at the time. I love, you know, again, the ambiguity of her character, but at the same time, yeah, I agree with you. I think it's very obvious that she's a lesbian. I love the way the film deals with it. I love that at the same time, because it's a Walter Hill movie, everyone is so masculine in this film. Everyone is so strong in this movie. You know, and I guess other than Brewster's Millions, I think every one of his movies are that way. But I think my favorite quality about all these characters, Maureen Jahan's included, everybody is so mythic. These battles are mythic. When Tom Cody and Willem Dafoe's character have a pickaxe battle at the end of the movie, it feels like the ultimate battle between good and evil. The whole film feels like that. There's no, like, it's nothing about this film is mild or half-assed. Everything is like a very important moment. It's like a Greek myth. It's like a Greek adventure the whole way through. I do like, and I agree with you, Keith, I like Michael Perret in this film very much. I once had a conversation with Robert Dennerstein about Rebecca Romijn's performance in Brian De Palma's movie Femme Fatale, and he was saying, like, you don't think she's a good actress, you? And my angle was like, you know what, I don't think Rebecca Romijn's a great actress, but she's great in that movie. And that's exactly how I feel about him in this film. He does seem like this amazing, you know, like this, it's like you got into the Brundlefly machine and you got James Dean and Elvis Presley to meld into this perfect human being. He is, you know, it's a shame that the film career didn't happen, because I do feel like that here's another guy who was just very interesting, and I don't know that he ever found a role that was just perfect for him, but he's great in this film because it is about a man who's defined by his actions. He's defined by whatever he's doing at that moment. None of the characters have a lot of depth, and that's fine because it's not that kind of film. We're constantly learning who they are as they go along. It's interesting that Rick Moranis seems like one of the only grown-ups in this movie, because everyone else, it has like a very much a high school Grease sort of thing going on. But and I think that's fine. You know, this movie, as we talk about it, the last thing I want to throw out there before I turn the conversation back over, this film is so ahead of its time, because we think about it like the world that Walter Hill created, like this is exactly what Warren Beatty did with Dick Tracy. This is exactly what Rodriguez did with Sin City. This is a world that's, you know, even like Dark, even something like Dark City or Blade Runner. It's a world that's, you know, it's a lived in world. It looks like a real place. It doesn't, you know, it doesn't look like it, like a bunch of sets. And obviously some of it is real locations and some of it were sets, but in any case, like it feels like a real tangible place. And, you know, I just feel like not only is the movie indescribable, but the existence, this world, it's almost dreamlike, you know, the way the different motifs and the different time eras seemingly kind of live in this, and it's like, God, like this soundtrack if it only come out like a decade later when Meatloaf, like when they used to show Meatloaf videos on MTV, like in 1990, you know, like in, like there's a song in the end credits by The Fix, Deeper Deeper, which I love. And I love it because like the Fix song and the Dan Hartman song, I know his name. I feel like those songs are like, they almost feel like they don't belong in the movie in a sense. They're very out of sync with the rest of the song. And I think that's totally fine. My point is like, this movie feels like it was just like 5 or 6 years too early, you know? And inevitably it wound up influencing everything that came after it. But most people to this day, this movie doesn't have the cult following.
No, absolutely. And I'm not even certain if it can even get that cult following eventually. I mean, you know, there are many film programmers I know and have met who like Streets of Fire is on their list. Like, of like, yes, like they love it. But I think it just seems like a lot of work for all of us programmers to get together and make this film develop a super big cult following. Like, and because of everyone involved in it too, it's like, aside from Willem Dafoe and Diane Lane to a degree, but she started, you know, I hate to say she's aged out, but like the idea where she is now, Streets of Fire seems kind of like a cute anomaly, I guess, yeah, to her career. Like when people discover, which a film that she did 2 years before, Ladies and Gentlemen, The Fabulous Stains, yeah, where she was the lead singer of a girl punk band. And I think probably picked up a little bit of those chops for Streets of Fire. I don't know. Yeah, I don't know exactly what it would take in the now to have people be like, oh, let me see this. Like, you know, it's not a bad movie. Like, this is one of those that I literally cannot say there's anything bad about it. Like, it's not in the sense of some cult films that are like, well, the movie's not very good, but it has this. It's a good movie. It just is presented in such a way that it just is hard to get people super interested. Now, mind you, like, David, you said that you watched the trailer and you were like, oh my God, why haven't I ever seen this? And that trailer's been out for a while. And I think I've showed that trailer to a few people too. And they're like, oh, that looks good. But yeah, what actually makes people be like, let me check this. And then let me also tell like 5 extra friends to watch it or share it with, you know, other people. I don't know if it'll ever get its like its due, and maybe that's okay. You know,
well, it's almost like you almost need something like Joe Bob to pick it up at this point, like someone who would actually span a bunch of folks, which I don't like, because it's better to have like that local film community, like we've got it at the C, or you've got like that the Music Box in Chicago or other places like that.
Mm-hmm. And you know, I, because Universal did a new restoration DCP of it, probably I think for its anniversary last year. And they didn't push it. Like their interest isn't huge. It's I contemplated it for the Film on the Rocks drive-in this season. But
I might have had to go to that for sure.
Yeah, but I don't know that we'd get more that, like, I don't know. It's there's gonna be films that I take a risk on up there, and I think that one's a huge risk. And that's a problem. Like I do wish I could just plant it in. And people would be like, yes, Streets of Fire, and or let me take a chance on this at the drive-in. Man, to see Streets of Fire at the drive-in actually would be really great.
I mean, but short of like making it a B film as part of a double feature or something, that'd be, I totally get, like, getting the crowd in could be kind of tough.
Exactly. So just got to figure out when we start to do double features, if we do that at Film on the Rocks, then I got to figure out what the good A movie is that goes to this B. But no, that, like you were saying, Barry, it kind of is like a little Black Mirror-ish in a way, like as a setting where it's like, it's now, maybe, kind of. Wait, what time is this? I don't know. Like in 84, it would have just seemed like, from music to other things, like, oh, things are 1984-ish, except for all these 50s cars and outfits and stuff like that. And you got a perfectly working like subway car system and there's all these other things. You're just like, nah, it's a different multiverse, I suppose, of a John Wayne film.
I feel like I'm missing out that I never saw this on the big screen and never saw this with an audience. It just, even watching it, because like yourself, I revisited it just recently, just watching it, it's like, God, this movie, it lives and breathes for the big screen. Watching it on HBO, cropped my little boxy TV in the 80s, I've got this, the Shout Factory release, which I think is wonderful, and I think they did a good job with it. And I feel like that's the first time in my life I've really gotten the sense of the scope of it and really enjoyed it, especially the editing choices, which are fantastic. This movie, the editing calls attention to itself, but it just eclipses every scene to its essence. It has a great rhythm with the music. It's such a richly cinematic experience. I completely agree with you, and I woe anyone who would watch this film with the sound off. But you're absolutely right. It is one of those films. I mean, Hill is in his element in this movie. It's so cool to see just how untethered he is for this film. I mean, at one point, I can't imagine today, well, maybe today, but like in 1984, I can't imagine, you know, anyone other than Walter Hill getting away with Willem Dafoe entering a scene where he's literally walking through just a pillar of fire. It's like the devil has entered the scene. It's not subtle.
In vinyl overalls. Shirtless in vinyl overalls.
It's spectacular. It is so wonderful. And again, like if I were watching it with the sound off, it's like, well, that's clearly the villain. There's no question what's going on here. It almost works like in a silent film way, but it's like, again, this is the essence of cinema, and Hill does this over and over again. It helps that he understands the Western so well. I love his Westerns. I'm a big fan of Walter Hill's Westerns. But again, like everything, I mean, 48 Hours, Johnny Handsome, most of his films, with the exception of Brewster's Millions, most of his movies feel like Westerns, and this movie is no different. And it's just wonderful to find, you know, if anybody ever wanted to understand like the aesthetic of a Western, like, you know, how you can create a neo-Western, how you could apply that genre to so many different films. I mean, just watch a Walter Hill film. Like he completely gets it. And it's all over this movie. The way Tom Cody slings his gun over his shoulder, it's like, oh, it's so badass because this is like what Randolph Scott did like 60 years ago. It's so cool.
Well, and even like, you know, Tom Cody taking out, instead of taking out men on horseback, he takes out the motorcycles outside the
countries.
You know, what other movie is going to feature a climactic battle between the hero and the villain with pickaxes? You know?
With this amazing Mexican standoff. Yeah. Oh, it's fantastic. It's so cool. Because again, it's like, it's not, you know, it's not like we get a backstory for Defoe's character or Tom Cody is like, you know, like a flawed hero. Like, no, like, Tom Cody is definitively the good guy, you know, in a James Dean-ish way, but he's still the definitively good guy. And Dafoe is playing Satan, essentially. So this, the stakes of this battle are huge. All of the main characters in this, it's almost like a Shakespearean kind of ending where the main characters are watching, you know, Hamlet and Laertes having their final battle. It's good stuff. And I love the way it's staged and, you know, Hill gets us really close into the action. So you really do, I mean, you get the sense that these two actors are just spending all day just smacking those hammers at each other.
I love how basic it is.
Basic for sure.
Like it's literally like it's where the good guys are good and the bad guys are bad and the women are beautiful. Yeah. Like that's the movie pretty much in a nutshell. And it makes it work. It could be really hokey, but it pulls it off beautifully.
Yeah. And you know, there's extra little touches too, like you were saying, with this feeling like the future of sorts. Or at least very modern, you know, it's the 50s, but there are black people in the film in roles like the chief of the police. Yeah. I believe he was like the captain or chief of the police. And it's just not a thing. Like it's not, even the Shirelles, it's not about them being black on a bus. The only odd thing is just that they're just on a bus and they clash with the cops. It's not about like, oh no, the cops are gonna harass us because we're black. Like it's a past time but through a future lens where racism wasn't an issue, where it was just more about cops are bad, which is just always going to be eternal, and whatever, you know, and good versus evil.
Even with Tom and Cody's sister, like that was always something interested me because she's single. Mm-hmm. And the movie doesn't like apologize for that. Like, so like her husband died or whatever, or, you know, she's, you know, her kids have moved out. No, she's a single woman. She's running this diner. She's clearly kicking ass. She doesn't need an explanation.
He like, even says, progressive. He's like, I'm not going to cramp your style staying over tonight. You got any gentleman callers? And she says, oh, I've had a few run through, but nothing stuck. And you're just like, get it. You're just, you're like, you know what? Man sucks. This is just the way it is. Whatever.
Yeah.
You know, much in the same way that when Amy Madigan comes to stay on the couch, he tells her, like, you're making a girl, you brought a girl over and she's sleeping on the couch. What happened? Like, yeah.
And we, we have to talk about the amazing cameos in this movie. Like, we got Robert Townsend. I mean, Blanken, you'll miss him pretty much. You've got Ed Begley Jr. as just the fun homeless hobo guy who gets paid off or whatever. And then Bill Paxton is so much fun in his little bit. Like, talk about maximizing your time on the screen. His interactions with Amy Madigan are just gold every time they're on the screen together.
Bill Paxton during this time, this is when he was really nothing. And I think he was so happy to be in any movie in like 1982, 83, 84 that he was just like, if I'm going to get on screen, I'm going to just, I'm going to act for the back row is basically what it is. And I love it.
It's almost like True Lies level Bill Paxton, which is like some of the best Bill Paxton you're going to get.
Exactly. And why am I forgetting her name? I have IMDb open up really fast for me. E.G. Daily as Baby Doll, the girl that they meet in the weird like 80s mall city that they stop off in on the way back to their city, where there's like TVs playing like MTV, Ellen Ames video. Anyway, more of the fun stuff that encapsulates this. But yeah, E.G. Daily popping up here. This movie's got it all, kids.
Now,
it's run out and walk.
I don't disagree with you that this film is pretty much perfect, but I want to throw this out here. Would this film have been maybe just a little bit better if E.G. Daily had played Ellen Ames? What do you think?
I'm going to say no, only because E.G. is always bubbly, is what I always feel that if I see her in something, it's because she's got to be that little air of bubbly. She never played a serious character, at least during that time frame.
Yeah.
You know, she was always a little too innocent. And Diane Lane at that time, you know, she did Ladies and Gentlemen, The Fabulous Stain. She did Rumblefish. She did The Outsiders just before this. And then she just, I think I've always described it with her. This movie captures her at that moment where she still has her baby fat. Like, she still has this fullness in the face that is so just like gorgeous for any actress of the time, especially one that just has to be. I mean, we have to believe that she's at the top of the world, that she's kind of this, you know, Madonna-esque figure in pop. And I don't know that E.G. would have personified that exactly. But another multiverse to travel where we could completely recast this. I will say as a warning, there is a sequel that developed many years later that was filmed Sin City style on like green screen backgrounds. Avoid it at any costs. Even though it features Michael Paré and Deborah von Valkenburg, she cameos in it as well. No. Just don't do it.
I wanted to ask you about that. I didn't know that this existed until last night. What was it like as a diehard Streets of Fire fan to come across it? I mean, was it like watching Showgirls 2 or Kindergarten Cop 2? Is it that level of awful?
Kind of. But I anticipated that. Like, having seen like a trailer for it, I was like, ooh, no. This is not, you know, but I went into it being like, okay, let's see what Sun's doing here. I'll give him a benefit of a doubt to turn it around real quick. But right away, I was like, oh no, this is not, this is not what this film deserves. Especially when you get to the end of this movie, which, unless it was going to be written by Larry Gross and directed by Walter Hill again, with the exact same cast, there's no need for a sequel or a second story. And there's just so much magic that comes in that ending too, with, you know, this concert is going on. There is action going on camera. We're cutting in between the Shirelles doing their song, and then Tom talks to Ellen backstage and kind of gives her this, sorry, gotta go, kid, kind of thing, but they still have their like final moment. And then he stays to watch her number, and then into her number, like it hits his apex, and then he's just like, I'll grab my bag and go. And then we get our final little bit with McCoy outside. But there's a part of me watching that and rewatching it today where, A, I still get chills when he leaves the theater, like when he finally just turns around and walks out the theater. But just this notion that there's a part of me that's like, man, what would that next story be? Obviously, I think it would have been something separate from Ellen. Like, it would have been wherever he's headed off to. In fact, it probably would have been Tom, Cody, and McCoy on some kind of other adventure somewhere else. And that I really could have gotten behind.
Oh, for sure.
But what this other sequel turns into is a mess, is all that it turns into. So
it's
boy, it all costs.
You know, there's an interesting thing, like, if Michael Paré hadn't played it straight ahead the way he had for the entire movie, that ending would have been god awful. Because like in any other movie with any guy with half a brain, like, dude, life is set. Everything is set here in front of you, but has set himself, you know, that character is played so stoic through the entire thing, and he has other responsibilities, and he's just like, look, this isn't going to work out. And you buy it. Like, it's still, there's that pang of, man, I wish he would have stuck around, but you totally get why he left. And if he isn't that earnest and isn't playing it that straight the whole way through, it doesn't pay off and it doesn't work.
Yeah. Exactly. So.
Yeah. So
there we go. We got a perfect movie wrapped up top to bottom.
There we go. In under an hour. And considering this movie is so tight at an hour and a half, like, there are movies that I've watched that have been like 75 minutes, like this movie was 20 minutes too long. There is, like you said, there is nothing to cut from this movie. Like, it is, it starts and you are on for the ride for the next hour and a half. So yes, it is available for, I think, you know, there's no streaming services that have it right now. So you pretty much have to buy it on Blu-ray or buy it on the streaming service of your choice. But I think we all highly recommend checking it out.
It's a good purchase, folks.
Yeah.
Shout Factory.
Yeah, especially the Shout Factory release is a delight. I have two copies. I have that one you showed, and then I have the Steelbook.
Ooh, that's beautiful. Wow. What a great cover.
I also have it on beta. Which was more of a at a, someone was selling it at like a garage sale, and I was like, I might as well claim this.
It's going to a good home.
Yeah, like, it's more of an art piece for me. I'll probably hang it on a wall in the kitchen.
Absolutely. And
it's like, hey guys, I got a beta player. Does anybody have any beta? Well,
yep,
you're all set. What was I going to say? that you just derailed me completely and utterly. Well done. Shout Factory runs sales once in a while. I know the Steelbook was on sale for like $17 not too long ago. So keep an eye out there as well. Keith, what have we got coming up on Film on the Rock? Since I'm going to turn this around like within less than 24 hours, what's coming up the next few weeks if anyone wants to catch anything that y'all are doing?
Ooh, let me bring up our lineup. Well, these first 3 weeks are sold out, but beginning Labor Day weekend, we have Tu Wong Fu, Thanks for Everything, Julie Newmar, Love and Basketball, Princess Bride, Star Wars, the original New Hope will be playing, Fight Club, Selena, Remember the Titans, Empire Strikes Back, Bridesmaids, Friday, Rocket Man, and Return of the Jedi.
Wow. Awesome.
Nice. Very nice. So I have to ask, which version of Star Wars are you showing? There's like 8,000 different versions of it.
Here we go.
I mean, the perhaps most recently released, whatever that is, the like studio release. There's no distinction. They have so much control over it now that it's like you're seeing what they're releasing. There's no like the original cut or like, you know, we're always going to have the updates that Lucas did. That's just going to get used to it, people. That's how it's going to look from now on.
Or go seek out that old two-disc DVD that's going for obscene amounts of money if you really want the theatrical cut.
Yes, or your old VHS tape from back in the day.
Exactly. Cool. Is Rocket Man the Elton John one or the one from 97 with Harlan Williams?
Oh, the Elton John one.
Yeah, just want to make sure.
If I was gonna do that Rocket Man and not Streets of Fire, then that would be a problem. I was gonna take a risk on something. So,
I think you found your A movie.
Yeah.
No. So Keith, where can people find out more, pick up tickets, all that fun stuff?
At denverfilm.org. We also have our own virtual cinema platform running there, where I think we've got almost 30 new films on the platform right now. Nice. It changes weekly. We add more, take away a few, but it's the best of current art house, foreign documentary, etc. is all right there at your fingertips, all at denverfilm.org. And who knows, we don't have any date yet in mind for reopening the C Film Center. We are being cautious and safe for our audience and for our staff, and God bless the people that are opening theaters this weekend and going to movies this weekend here in Denver. Personally, I don't feel it's worth it just yet. So
that is absolutely fair. That's absolutely fair. Barry, what have you got going on? Uh-oh, did I lose everyone?
I'm sorry, what was that? You broke up a little bit.
Oh, sorry about that. No, what have you got coming up?
What I have coming up? I have an article on Miller's Crossing I'll be publishing very soon. Miller's Crossing is turning 30 years old, and I think it's one of the masterpieces, not only of the Coen brothers, but of the gangster genre in general. And I just published today I wish it was controversial, but really, I think people either find it amusing or will just completely overlook it. I wrote an article on the Beastmaster, why the Beastmaster is still a part of pop culture, why people are still obsessed with this Don Coscarelli oddity from 1982, which opened the same year as Conan the Barbarian, and yet it has a far more devout cult following. So my article is about the appeal of all things the Beastmaster. And that's on the Hit site.
Very nice. And next week... We have a new release to talk about, Barry.
Wow, we do. Yeah.
Yay.
Wow.
So yeah, I know I'm ponying up. Are you ponying up for the full $25 to get Bill and Ted 3?
You know, between that or Mulan, yes, I'll do Bill and Ted. I've given up on Mulan months ago, but Bill and Ted 3, for whatever insane reason, I'm still under the delusion that it's going to be a great film. I'm trying to measure those expectations, but you know, it could go either way.
Yeah, well, you've got a great surrounding cast, so yes, we're going to release that next weekend, which means it's going to be another short turnaround. Keith, thank you so much for joining us, sir. Again, a happy birthday to you, and thanks for joining us to talk about such a beloved film from you.
Thank you guys so much. Yes, I will never not talk about Streets of Fire whenever given the opportunity. So,
and now I understand why.
Providing this platform. There you go. And now share it with, well, you're sharing it with the whole podcast, but personally loan a copy to some poor soul that has not seen it yet.
Well, that's the other thing is like, it's part of Movies Anywhere. So they've just started doing that loan out feature so that now don't email me asking for me to loan my copy to you, but I've absolutely offered to do that for several friends already.
Yeah. Well, there you go.
Yes. All right, folks. Thank you so much for joining us. We'll catch you next week when we talk a little Bill and Ted. But until then, this is Dave.
This is Ben.
I'm
Keith.
Yeah, Keith. Yay, Keith. Thanks so much. Take care. Oh, he's coming back, folks.